Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Didn't mean to startle you. On behalf of the Board of Directors of Junior Achievement, it is my pleasure to welcome you to this wonderful evening as Junior Achievement hosts the 31st Annual Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame Dinner and Ceremony. My name is Melissa Davis. I'm the District Director. It is truly a pleasure and honor to be here. Tonight we'll pay tribute to some brilliant innovators in their chosen fields. We are dedicating tonight's program to the memory of a past laureate of the Hall of Fame who we lost in January, Bruce Upchurch. Before we get started with our program this evening, we would like to do a moment of silence in honor of Bruce. Thank you. At this time, will the members of the Board of Directors for Junior Achievement please stand and be recognized? I would like to take this time to publicly thank you for your contributions to JA, and actually a lot of them are backstage. Some of them are over here. And back. I also want to thank all of you that have supported our programs this past year, which have continued with virtual options. And we also have volunteers going back into the classroom. Whether financially or through volunteering, we could not reach over 3,000 students each year without your support. We continue to have more teachers reaching out to us each year asking for JA programs for their students. And this year is certainly no exception, as getting volunteers back into the classroom has been exciting for the students, teachers, as well as the volunteers. We are always in need of new classroom volunteers. At any time for the remainder of the spring, we will have dozens of volunteer openings. If you're interested in receiving more information on being a JA mentor, to help young people succeed and dream big, please take a business card off of your table and reach out to me. And I'd like to congratulate tonight's laureates who, over the past few months, I've had the privilege to learn a lot about them by talking with them and their close friends and family, about their successes in life and business and their huge impact in their communities. And I've heard many stories too, some quite entertaining. Sue, Mike, and George, you are truly deserving of this honor, and I look forward to celebrating each of you this evening. Congratulations, and thank you for investing in our community and being a leader for the next generation to follow. And now we are on with the show. I would like to introduce and give a special thank you to our MC for this evening, Mr. Rick Duncan.
Good evening. How is everyone doing? Everybody all right? Having a good night so far? Good. I'm so glad you're here. Welcome to the Junior Achievement Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame. So join me in welcoming the 2022 honorees and their families. Our first laureate tonight, Mike Kramer, Primex Plastics. Mike is escorted tonight by his daughter Chelsea and his son Greg. Our second laureate tonight, George Farrell, Bath State Bank, escorted tonight by his granddaughter, Adrian. And our final laureate tonight, Sue Miller from Brady Ware, escorted by her granddaughter, Elizabeth. To our 2022 laureates, tonight we honor you for giving not only of your time, your talents, and your enthusiasm, but also for the passionate leadership, encouraging and inspiring others to do the same. So those being honored tonight join a list of outstanding individuals and respected leaders that have made legendary contributions to the free enterprise system, invested in the growth and success of the community, and inspired the next generation. This is the 31st commemoration of the JA of Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame. And we're very fortunate to have some of our past honorees in attendance tonight. Our past laureates are being escorted by JA students from Seton Catholic Junior High. First, John Ford at his seat, laureate from 2008. John? John McBride, laureate from 2014. Gary Clear, laureate from 2015. I forgot, Gary paid me to say he's my favorite laureate. There you go, okay, there you go. I got you. Next up, Bob Beaver, laureate from 2016. Jeff Jackson, laureate 2017. Eric Van Vliet, laureate 2018. Deborah Edelman, laureate 2019. Richard Peterson, laureate 2020. Roger Golden, laureate 2021. And Craig Kenyon, laureate from 2021. So, if you would, please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance, led by JA student Case Towns. Following the pledge, please remain standing for the invocation given by JA student Caitlin Scheiben.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please bow your heads. Thank you, God, for bringing us together to celebrate junior achievement. In this year's honorees, in a world where many are hungry, may we eat this food with humble hearts. In a world where many are lonely, may we share our friendship with joyful hearts. In a world where there is much need, may we always strive to use our efforts and resources for good. Bless us, O Lord, in these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty through Christ our Lord. Amen.
This is my favorite part. You may be seated. I always feel like I have so much power when I do that. I have four kids. I have no power at all, so it's nice to be able to do that. And people listen. That's what I meant. Okay. So, if you like the centerpieces on your table, well, those were put together by Flowers by Carla. And someone at your table is going to take that home. Here's what you need to do. Look under your chair. If you've got a yellow card, that centerpiece is yours. If you have a yellow card under your seat, she was getting after it. Let's just dump that seat over. She wanted that. I don't even think that's her chair. All right, everybody good? Everybody got their Everybody got their centerpieces taken care of? Good. All right. So, now it brings us to the portion that we like to call the world's fastest fundraiser. Here's how it works. The goal is to raise $1,500 in 15 seconds. And I think we can do that. Here's what's gonna happen. So, Lori Carr, there she is.
This thing weighs more than I do.
Okay, Lori Carr is hefting this massive dessert basket. There you go. Take a gander at that thing. So now what we're gonna do is, whatever table raises the most money gets that gift basket. So, now we're motivated, right? Now we got some motivation going. Okay, so it was put together, by the way, my friends at Reed's Cafe at 1200. So, thank you for that. So here we go. There's an envelope at your table, right in the middle. Take that envelope and stuff it full of cash or checks or any form of denomination you've got. And also, if you didn't happen to bring cash or checks, which why would you come to a fundraiser and not bring cash or checks, but it's fine, it's the electronic age. There is a Venmo on the screen, at least there will be soon. Check out the Venmo account. The district director's Venmo name is gonna come up and you can donate that way with your table number. Make sure you put your table number that you're gonna donate with. Is it? Okay. Yeah. All right, so there we go. So 15 seconds, ready? Go. All right, stuff those envelopes. Are we stuffing? Keep going, dig deep. It's a fundraiser. Pass it around. Make sure the person with the deepest pocket has it. You can obviously stuff a credit card in there if you like. 5 seconds left. I mean, we won't put that much on it. I'm sure it's got a good limit. Keep going, keep going. 3, 2, 1, and we're done. All right, nice job, well done. All right, okay. So we have stuffed our envelopes. Now it's the part of the evening where we get to stuff ourselves. Ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy your dinner. Well, please continue with your dinner, but we would like to say thanks to tonight's sponsors of the event. I like your mustache. Thank you to our title sponsor, Primex Plastics. Also the banquet sponsors. Thank you to First Bank Richmond and Reed Health. Yes, feel free to applaud. Guest reception sponsors include BNF Plastics, Indiana University East, Integrity Metals, Recycling Center Incorporated, Wayne Bank, and Whitewater Broadcasting. Special thanks go out to table sponsors, Bath State Bank and Bradyware. Contributing sponsors include Coldwell Banker Lingle and Earlham College. Our guest speaker sponsor is the Quig Fund, as well as Armstrong Cleaners, Cafe at 1200, Flowers by Carla, Forest Hills Country Club, Heartbreakers, Lee's, Meyer, WCTV, and let's give a round of applause for Pat O'Neill for sharing the music with us tonight. He always does a fantastic job. Big thanks to all of our generous sponsors. Obviously, events like this could not go on without them, so we greatly appreciate it. The generosity of these sponsors and their commitment to junior achievement are greatly appreciated. So our guest speaker tonight is someone that Hoosier basketball fans will not need an introduction for. But for the other two or three of you, Bobby Plump is who the character Jimmy Chitwood in the movie Hoosiers was based on. The Milan Indians went all the way to the state title, beating Muncie Central 32-30. So Bobby Plump lived the dream that every boy in Indiana who's ever picked up a basketball has always had. You dribble it out, you're going for the state title, you shoot the last second shot, you win. That's what happened. That's the dream he lived. He's an Indiana legend, one of America's treasures, and a small town guy that I think we can all identify with. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bobby Plump.
If I was coordinated, I'd be dangerous. Thank you all. Thank you. What a pleasure to be here, and congratulations to all of the awardees and all the past awardees and the other people that are here to enjoy this. I'd like to start out by telling you that I don't make a living as a public speaker, and you'll find that out as I go along here. In fact, when I was in college, I'm not from Milan. I'm from a little town called Pierceville, 3 miles from Milan. We all went to Milan school. On a good day, we'd have 100 people in our town. And I was a shy, bashful kid. I went to Butler University, and I had to take a speech class. Dr. Kripe was a speech professor, and he told me I had to know three things: my name, where I'm from, and what I'm talking about. I got 2 out of 3 right, and he passed me. And he gave me some of the best information I've ever had about public speaking. He said, "Bob, I want to tell you the next time and in the future, have a great beginning, have a great ending, and for goodness sake, keep them as close together as possible." So I'm going to try and do that this evening. I want to tell you that it is absolute a miracle that I'm standing up here coming from Pierceville. I thought that here's maybe 100 people. Everybody kind of thought the same thing. I thought if you lived in Indianapolis or Richmond or especially New York City, you had to be a lot smarter than I was because I didn't know anything. The best education I had was when I went to college, not in the classroom, but in meeting other people. And it took me a while, but I found out that people are just people. They have the same wants, the same desires. It is just a difference of personalities that go along. I didn't know that coming from such a small town. That was a great education. And then because of what happened in 53 and 54, it gave kids on our team and my classmates an opportunity to go to college, and it expanded our knowledge. Even today, 9 out of 10 of us went to college. That'd be pretty good today even, going to college, but this is 1954. How much influence did the coaches have on us? 6 of my teammates, by the way, you could only dress 10 back then for the tournament, but 6 of my teammates ended up coaching and going into education. That's how much influence the coaches have, and they still have today. We were very, very fortunate. You know, it was such an unusual thing. I have given speeches at athletic banquets, and I often hear at these banquets, or I used to, say, "Well, we won the sectional, but we knew we couldn't beat the big team when we got to the regional." And I thought, yeah, you're right. If you didn't think you were going to win, you sure weren't going to win. We were lucky. Milan had never won a game in the regional. This is for the younger people out here. Milan had never won a game in the regional in the history of our school. We had a new coach that came in our junior year. They just fired the coach, and we had the best season Milan ever had. And the principal didn't like him. They fired him. The new coach came in. He was 24 years old, changed our whole system around just like they did in the movie Hoosiers. In 1953, after having never won a game in the regional, we met a team, Knightstown Memorial, Home for Orphan Children. And they had us down nine. You have to have a little luck when you go along the way, folks. And every awardee here will tell you that throughout their life, they had a little luck along the way. It took a lot of hard work, but they had a little luck. Here was our luck. We're down 9 points with a minute and 48 seconds to go. And we had the ball. We stole it three times in a defense that Marvin Wood, our coach, brought to us. We get within 2 points. There's 21 seconds shown on the clock. We had the ball and we threw it in. We're down two. The timer forgot to start the clock. I'm telling you, 5,000 fans in Rushville are standing, screaming their heads off, throwing coins on. The officials finally saw it. Went over to the scorer's bench. We're in the huddle wondering what's going on. It seemed like a half an hour. Maybe it was 2 or 3 minutes. They never took any time off the clock. With zero showing on the clock, Ray Kraft, who was a substitute that year, hit a layup and we tied the game. First overtime, it's tied. The second overtime, the first 2 points back then wins. You could hit a free throw, they hit a free throw, you hit another free throw, you won the game. I hit two free throws. We won the first game in the history of Milan High School. Four fans with coat and ties showered with us. We had a weekly newspaper. The newspaper came out and says, Milan steals from orphans. I gave a speech someplace around here, and the man, it was near Rushville. After I got finished, this gentleman came up and said, I'm the timer. His name was Ernie Privet, and I said, what in the world happened? Did you have a, he said, the plug came out of the time clock. We didn't know how much time ran off, so we didn't take any. I simply asked him if it was a man from Milan, maybe sitting next to him in that plug. A little bit of luck. 53 was more like the movie Hoosiers. There's a double overtime. We had a two-point game that night. We go to the semi-state. We had an overtime game. That night, we played Shelbyville, and it's still a record. We beat them 43-21, and the record is, I didn't know this, David Halberts from the Pulitzer Prize writer called me one time and wanted me to look up some statistics. We held them to two field goals. They were 2 for 45 from the field. That's still a record. Probably will never be broken. Then we got it handed to us in the morning game of the Final Four. But we had never won a game in the regional. That little bit of luck, Ernie Privet and the time clock gave us an opportunity. And if you talk with all these award winners here, they will tell you along the way, someplace, they've also had a little bit of luck. All right, I want to say something to the younger folks here. I wrote a few things down earlier. I want to tell you all something. You're going to make some mistakes along the way. That's part of life. There isn't anybody that goes through life without making a mistake. Again, that's part of life. The mistake is not trying something. It's okay to fail. These award winners will tell you they have had some failures in their life also. It's like a football coach once said, it isn't terrible that you get knocked down on the football field. It's terrible if you don't get up and try again. So don't be afraid to try things. Take advantage of all that you're learning, these younger people here, and congratulations to all of you that are helping them through Junior Achievement. What a great, great program. All of you, give yourself a hand. And to the younger people, remember this. Each of you are important. Each of you have an impact. Each of you affect other people. And each of you make a profound difference. I want you to look at somebody, everybody, look at the person next to you at the table. Smile at them, will you? Yeah. Doesn't that feel good? That's part of life too. If you can make somebody smile every day, you're going to feel good about yourself and they're going to feel good. That didn't take too much effort, did it? It's an important lesson. There's too many things going on in the world that they're blaming this person. I blame that person. I blame that person. Take responsibility for yourself and follow through and see if you can make somebody else's life happier. If you can, you have succeeded and you're going to be happier. One more thing about athletics. It is a privilege, not a right. You ought to accept it as a privilege. It is not a right. You earn on the athletic field, you earn the same thing that you're going to earn in life. Never was an athlete that won everything they ever tried. Never was a person that it succeeded in everything they tried. The secret is to try. Continue to go and continue to try and strive and make yourself and somebody else happy. And I'm going to close. I had a limit here, and I think I'm probably there, right? Yeah, I thought so. I'm going to read this poem that I discovered when I was giving talks from high school. Back then, that's when I said, my name is Bobby Plump, and I get all sweaty and all those things, you know. This is a poem by C.W. Longnecker. If you think you are beaten, you are. If you think you dare not, you don't. If you'd like to win, but think you can't, it's almost a cinch, you won't. If you think you'll lose, you're lost, for out in the world you'll find success begins with a fellow's will. It's all in the state of mind. For many a race is lost, or ever a step is run, and many a coward fails, or ever his work's begun. Think big, and your deeds will grow. Think small, and you'll fall behind. Think that you can and you will. It's all in a state of mind. If you think you're outclassed, you are. You've got to think high to rise. You've got to be sure of yourself before you can ever win a prize. Life's battles don't always go to the stronger or faster man. But sooner or late, the man who wins is a fellow who thinks he can. My apologies to the female society out there. And thank you so much for inviting me. Have a great evening.
Stand right here if you like. All right, so obviously, let's give one more hand to Bobby Plump. I mean, it's one thing, you know, you've heard the story of Mylan, you've seen the movie Hoosiers, and then you see Bobby Plump in person, and, you know, I meet a lot of famous people, but I met him, and I was like, hi. Like, it's weird. Sorry. I'm sorry if that's weird. So, okay. So we've got a bundle of stuff that Bobby has autographed, including a basketball, a DVD of Hoosiers. We got a VHS tape of Hoosiers. We have a Bobby Plump bobblehead, a T-shirt, several autographed pictures, too. And we're going to auction all this off to one person. So, and this goes to your scholarship fund at Butler, correct?
Yeah, there is a scholarship in my name at Butler University, and it's going to be given to one athlete per year in perpetuity. That's where this money will go.
Okay, so it goes to the Bobby Plump Scholarship Fund at Butler. And let's start with 100. Who's got $100? All right, there's 100. Let's go 150. 150? About 200. Who's got 200? For all of this, you literally get all of this. 200? Okay. What? $1,000 right here. $1,500. Got $1,500 back there. $2,000 right here. $2,500? $2,500 right over there. $2,500. Who's got three? Who's got $3,000? Raise it high. There you go. $3,000 right over there. Do we have $3,500? $3,500. All right. Four. Who's got $4,000? This all goes to the Bobby Plump Scholarship Fund at Butler. We've got $3,500. We need four. Four over there. We got $4,000. $4,500. $4,500. Justin Shavin will not be denied. $4,500. $5,000. Who's got five? Who's got five? 45 is where we're at. There's five. Paul Whitty says, oh yeah? Five. 5,000. Do we have 55? 55. Six. Six right over here. 65. Six. We need 65. 65 over here. Seven. You're standing up, that means you vote. That's when you're in. 65, is that where we're at? 65, we need, is that right? Okay, we need seven. 65, we need seven. 65, going once. 65, going twice. $6,500, so there you go.
Thank you.
That's fantastic. All the autographed merchandise is yours. So there you go. Congratulations. Bobby, thank you again so much. Appreciate it. While we're speaking of raising money, remember our world's fastest fundraiser we did? We were trying for 1,500 in 15 seconds. Well, good news and bad news. Bad news is we didn't get 1,500. The good news is we raised $5,022 and 11 cents. Who threw in 11 cents? Okay, it all counts. It all spendable money. Yeah. Table 25 was our highest donating table. Where's table 25? Where are they at? Table 25 is somewhere over. Are they over there? Okay. Congratulations, table 25. All you have to do to get all your desserts is go over there, because apparently Lori Carr said she like threw out her back carrying that heavy dessert tray. So it's right at the table up front if you'd like to go and pick it up. All right, so let's now introduce our JA student guest of the evening from Seton Catholic Junior High. Do we have our guests from Seton Catholic Junior High? There they are. All right, come on over. Keep your making your way. There we go. All right, so what are your names and what do you want to do? What do you want to grow up when you grow up?
I'm Raven Towns, and I'd like to be an architect.
Architect, all right. What's your name?
I'm Kiana Bond, and I want to be a pediatrician.
Pediatrician, nice. Okay.
I'm Bradley Russo, and I want to be a lawyer.
Lawyer, all right.
I'm Nellie Gilliam, and I want to be an optometrist.
Oh, very cool.
I'm Johnny Ann McDonald, and I want to be a chiropractor.
Okay, and you?
I'm Sarah Swinney, and I want to be an anesthesiologist.
Nice, and congratulations. No one said radio. That's awesome. Nice job. Okay. And now, I believe they have a presentation for us.
Good evening, and welcome to this year's annual Junior Achievement Hall of Fame dinner. JA equips students with the tools and skills required to earn and keep a job in high-growth career industries.
Junior Achievement programs cover key topics such as critical thinking, communication, collaboration, creative skills, software skills, work priorities, and personal brands and job huntings, cover letters, interviews, and digital profiles.
JA programs are voluntarily led, kit-based, and can be employed in the classroom or a JA after-school program. JA courses include 5 to 7 45-minute sessions with additional extended learning activities and optional digital assets offered throughout.
They teach us about entrepreneurship and how to be a business owner. Can you name a few business leaders in our community?
Mike Kermit of Boston.
George Farrell of Bath State Bank.
Sue Miller of Brady Ware.
Many of these business leaders excelled in their respective fields which have become very vital aspects of our community.
The United States is part of a global economy. Large businesses are independent, meaning they depend on workers and supplies outside of their company and who are often in other parts of the country or other parts of the world.
Our school is a community business that runs well and is interdependent on other businesses. For example, a school is dependent on publishers that supply textbooks to the classrooms and magazines and books for the libraries, along with food and companies that supply cafeteria lunches and beverages.
Thank you for joining us at this year's Junior Achievement Hall of Fame dinner.
All right, give all those ladies another round of applause. Adults will tell you how nerve-wracking it is to stand in front of a room of people, let alone when your kid's standing in front of a room of adults, so. Okay, let's get started. For 3 decades, we've recognized those individuals who have played a major role in helping to shape the business environment here in Eastern Indiana. And tonight's inductees are no exception. These individuals, along with each of our past laureates, identified a need and had a dream and acted upon it, often breaking new ground in the process. In a few minutes, we're going to add 3 more names to the Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame. And like the leaders who preceded them, these 2022 laureates truly are role models whose stories should be shared with our young people and preserved for future generations. That's the purpose of the JA of Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame, to identify the leaders and present their compelling stories and celebrate their successes, to motivate the next generation of entrepreneurs, business, and community leaders. Our first recipient of the night is a respected and loyal leader of one of the largest companies in Wayne County, Mike Kermit.
Michael J. Kermit was born the first child of Mary Birch Kermit and Russell Kermit at Reed Memorial Hospital on June 16, 1955. He was the oldest of 7 kids: Bob, Carol, Steve, Jim, Anne Marie, and Lori. Mike attended St. Mary's Grade School for grades 1 through 8, Pleasant View Junior High for 9th grade, and was a member of the 1973 graduating class of Richmond High School. Indiana University East was his choice for college as they had just begun offering classes on the Earlham campus in the evening, and he enrolled for the fall semester in 1974. The next year, IU East opened their current campus with its first new building. The next years were school, work, and typical adult experiences. Mike even played basketball while at IU East. On October 15, 1976, a major event occurred for Mike and his brothers and sisters. His mother passed away, unexpectedly, at age 42. Mike had just turned 21. His brothers and sisters were all younger and still at home. This twist of fate would become the foundation of his career. During the reception after the funeral, Paul Birch struck up a conversation with Mike to catch up on what was going on in Mike's life in general and memories of family. Paul came every year to visit Richmond and attend the Indianapolis 500. This would be an annual event for Mike also over the next 44 years. When the discussions ended, Paul asked Mike if he would be interested in moving to New Jersey and joining Primex Plastics Corporation. The offer was appreciated, but not given much afterthought, given the circumstances of still being in school and all the other unknowns pertaining to his family and the immediate future. Over a four-week period of time, as things began to settle, Mike reached out to Paul, who suggested a quick visit out east just to get a feel for what was being presented. The week of Thanksgiving, Mike drove to New Jersey to spend a couple of days and then returned to Richmond in time for Thanksgiving dinner with the whole family of aunts, uncles, grandparents, with much to think about. Over the next several weeks, after a lot of thought, Mike accepted the opportunity and made the move to New Jersey, beginning his life at Primex on January 30th, 1977. Mike progressed over the next 5 years, holding several positions from shipping clerk to operator to assistant foreman and manager of specialty products. In 1979, he met his wife, Sharon. She worked for Primex in inside sales. The same year, Primex opened a location in Richmond, Indiana that 8 years later would become the corporate headquarters. In 1981, Primex acquired a small plant in Oakwood, Georgia, and Mike was offered a production manager role. Mike and Sharon both accepted offers to transfer, and with that move, they married September 26, 1981, honeymooned in Germany and the UK, and relocated to Oakwood, Georgia, 60 miles northeast of Atlanta. Over the next 11 years, Mike and Sharon had two children, Chelsea and Greg, and he continued to grow in the organization, assuming more responsibilities for New Jersey and two small color businesses. The next major career change occurred in 1994, when he was promoted to VP of Manufacturing for Primex. Over the next 6 years, Primex expanded from 4 to 8 sites dedicated to sheet manufacturing. In 2000, Paul Birch retired. Mike was offered the president's position from Dr. John Farber, owner and founder of ICC, the parent company of Primex.
I've known Mike for 35 years. We met in 1986 when my first company, CDF Corporation, was getting into thermoforming. We both shared a passion for manufacturing, a love for developing new products for the future, and working with people. It was a marriage of true minds. It wasn't long after meeting Mike that we became very good friends and remain so to this day. Mike is very humble. Mike is a manufacturing guy. In many ways, he personifies the American dream. Starting at the back end of an extruder and working his way up to be the president of Primex Corporation. Mike is also very fair and honest. He is the type of guy that you know always does the right thing, even when no one is watching. Over the 35 years I have known Mike, his title has changed, his responsibilities have changed, but he's always remained the same genuine Mike Kramer. For all these reasons and more, I'm very honored and grateful to be a friend and colleague of Mike Kramer.
Over the last 21 years, Primex has been fortunate to grow and prosper while navigating the economic and global hurdles of world trade through the financial crisis of 2008 to the pandemic of 2020.
You know, when the pandemic started, and we were all trying to figure out what we were going to do because our bank lobbies were closed, and we were trying to figure out how we could reopen safely. And Primex came up with a desk shield and a face mask that our employees could use so that their interactions with the customers would be safe. And they were very insightful. I know they developed some other products that they marketed to the community and marketed nationally, because I think there were some hospitals that bought quite a few of their face shields. And that was just something that they weren't doing. They came up with on the spur of the moment, and it really helped us get through the pandemic.
Today, Primex has grown to 9 locations across the United States and the United Kingdom. Primex has been the centerpiece of his professional journey while benefiting from unwavering support from his wife and family. The Primex extended family of dedicated employees and close business associates and friends have all helped make this journey that began 44 years ago here in Richmond a very rewarding career. Mike says his fondest business memory is Dr. Farber giving him the opportunity to lead the company and his faith in his ability to successfully run and grow this business.
Mike runs one of the biggest companies in Wayne County. They not only employ a lot of people, but they give back to the community, which I think is very significant. And over the years, Primex and Mike have become more involved in our community. Mike lends his talents to both the Reed Health Foundation Board and the Economic Growth Board. I think both organizations have benefited from his leadership. And also, Primex and Mike have made a lot of contributions to the community. They are always giving back. They have given back to organizations like Amigos, the Boys and Girls Club, Circle U, Girls Inc., Junior Achievement, and the Richmond Symphony Orchestra, just to name a few.
When Mike was transferred back to Richmond in 1994, he was happy to return to the town he was born and raised in. He has fond memories of growing up here, and was very happy to be able to raise his family in his hometown. They grew up playing sports on the same fields and went to the same schools that he did. He has been able to renew many old friendships from his school days and cultivate new ones. In his spare time, Mike enjoys traveling, golf, auto racing, and all sports.
Yeah, when Mike goes to visit the mesquite plant in Nevada, he flies into Las Vegas, and I can tell you he is so excited to see those employees that he has been known to exceed the speed limit on the highway between Mesquite and Las Vegas. So he's well known to the state troopers, probably on a first name basis, and I think now instead of stopping him, they just wave as he speeds by.
Mike's fondest personal memory is his 60th birthday trip to play Pebble Beach and then having dinner with family and friends in Carmel, and his San Francisco Napa trip, visiting Andretti Winery, arranged by Sharon. He's very proud of seeing his kids develop and graduate college and law school, but equally fulfilling is the success of his siblings and their kids, given that they all started from a similar place in life. Every one of them have been positive contributors in the community and with their careers. Mike is a member of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton Catholic Church, Knights of Columbus, Economic Growth Group, and the Reed Health Foundation Board. He is also a proud supporter of Circle U and the Boys and Girls Club.
I once heard the saying, try not to become a man of success, rather become a man of value. Mike Kramer is an example of both. He is a man of success, he is a man of value.
Junior Achievement is proud to honor one of this year's laureates for their 2022 Business Hall of Fame, Mr. Mike Kramer.
So before Mike comes up to accept his award, First, we've got a couple of congratulatory messages from Mike. The first one from John Farber, owner and founder of ICC Industries. And John says, Mike, we're proud to congratulate you for your recognition as the 2022 Laureate of the Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame. We've known you since you were a smart and ambitious young man and recognized your business leadership when we appointed you president of Primex. We continue to admire and appreciate your talents, success, and commitment to our company. Congratulations, sincerely, John J. Farber. And we got another letter from Blaise Sarcone, president of ICC. And Blaise says, Mike, congratulations on being inducted in the 2022 Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame. Since starting out your business career over four decades ago and earning your way up through the organization, you've led Primex as its president to become one of the industry-leading companies. Your business savvy, keen astuteness, sound judgment, along with your logical and practical thinking, and equally matched by your dedication and steadfast loyalty to Primex, its employees, and ICC. Your humbleness and respect for others are just some of the characteristics which distinguish you as a leader and one hell of a guy. It's a great pleasure working with you, and a greater pleasure and honor to be your friend. Congratulations again on your induction in the 2022 Eastern Indiana Business Hall of Fame. Best regards, Blaise Sarcone, president. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mike Kramer.
I was really hoping this is going to lead to a bank ad on a billboard. I love this bank. Totally unexpected, much appreciated. Just quickly, I want to congratulate all the current this year's laureates. All the past laureates, some are friends and are part of my life today, much appreciated. Gary's gotten to be a pretty much a steadfast, somebody who steps in when you need somebody to say a good word for you. So I appreciate that, Gary. I want to also thank my wife, Sharon, and children, Greg and Chelsea, for their support and love. A special shout out to my mom, who had a very strong presence in my life as I was growing up. And we had some great parents and grandparents that helped build our foundation for our lives. Thanks to my talented brothers and sisters who've always been there for me and supported. We've all been there for each other. This doesn't go all the way to Z. I've had many, many mentors, but Paul Birch, I owe a debt of gratitude for his faith and belief in me and the opportunity, and really appreciate it. Dr. Farber, you heard from, also provided me the opportunity and the faith and belief. Confidence and provide opportunities for my career. I've been associated over the years with so many good and dedicated people. Some are here tonight who I consider family, lifelong friendships with classmates and employees, customers and suppliers, you heard from Joe, and relationships from the outside. And I value these and appreciate them the most through these past 45 years. Growing up, I always wanted to be involved in business, entrepreneurship, and the whole process was always my dream. It's been a rewarding experience. I've tried to learn something every step of the way, and I do know that these supportive people and life influencers are a compilation of why and where I am today. Thank you very much. Very much appreciated. And God bless America.
Maybe the first time I've had to chase a Laureate. Did you hear Gary Clare with the jokes in the last one, huh? Good one. Look at you, Gary. All right, so next up, our second Laureate. It's a friend to everyone he knows, Mr. George Farrell.
George W. Farrell was born on May 20, 1956 in Richmond, Indiana, to parents John and Anna Marie Farrell. He has an older brother, John, and a younger brother, Dick. He has fond memories of growing up on the family farm in Richmond and playing sports with his brothers, cousin, and neighbor. They were always playing baseball or football outside or basketball in the barn. George and his brothers also raised cattle, fed and watered them, and took care of fencing. George says his younger brother, Dick, being the baby of the family, was exempt from getting in trouble. And his older brother, John, was the ornery one. Of course, George always followed him and did what he said. His brother never got in trouble because he was John Jr. That always left George to get all the blame, which means he got stuck with most of the feeding and watering. George played sports, starting in Little League and through high school. He attended Centerville High School and graduated in May 1974. His dad went to all the games because his mom worked nights at their pizzeria. During high school, George worked at the pizzeria too. Of course, it was when his mom said he had to. And it was typically after a tough football game or a basketball game. And his pay? Well, he got to eat all he wanted. His mom had the only pizzeria restaurant in Richmond at the time. George delivered all over town. His mom knew every street and alley and told him where to go. He says he never got the first nickel tip. College came around fast, and before he knew it, he was practicing baseball at Hanover College. He says he'll never forget the first few games there. The first game was in Kentucky, and the snow was blowing across the field. A couple of weeks later, they played at Findlay College in Findlay, Ohio, and they literally swept the snow off the infield. He thought he'd entered a winter baseball league. With hard work and dedication, by the end of his senior year, he made all-conference, broke the school home run record, and led the team in runs batted in. He played all over Indiana, Ohio, Kentucky, and Michigan. And his dad was always there, sitting in the stands at every game all 4 years. What an example. So when George's kids started playing sports, he tried his best to attend every game and event.
Three words stick out to me when I think of George Farrell. Great friend, family man, and honesty. When you tell George something, it's in confidence. He always gives great advice, and he's just there for you. And that's the best thing I can say about George, is he's always there for you.
There's that saying that, they broke the mold. And if you've met him, you know he is the most unique individual. There's so many sides to him, and I don't know of anybody that is like him. He's an extremely positive person. He thinks we can do anything. There's sky's the limit with him. He was always that way at the bank. In working with him for 21 years, I can't think of a day where he had a bad day.
George graduated Hanover College May 28, 1978 with a business degree. He started working for Household Finance Corporation right out of college and did that for 2 years. First National Bank in Richmond became his employer for the following 6 years, where he was branch manager and loan officer. During that time, he graduated from Agriculture Banking School at Purdue University. In 1986, he was planning on going to work at a bank in Liberty. The president of Bath State Bank heard that George was going to Liberty and gave him a call. After their conversation, George knew he wanted to go to Bath. His career at Bath State Bank started on June 9, 1986, and that's where he stayed for 32 years until his retirement on December 31, 2018. He started out as assistant vice president to vice president to executive vice president and head of lending. He became president and CEO in May of 2007, and he retired in 2018. He then worked part-time for the bank's holding company for the next 2.5 years. He's still on the board of directors and has held that position for 34 years.
Bath Bank, to know something about them, they're in a town of 10 houses and 30 people. Very small bank, and just by definition of that bank and what it needed to do to survive is you had to be an entrepreneur. You had to look for opportunities of how you could find your niche and expand upon it. When he came to the bank, we were doing business in a radius of about 7 miles away from the bank, probably reaching into a little bit of Liberty and College Corner, maybe a little bit of Brookville. And for us to survive, we knew we needed to expand that territory. That's where the entrepreneurial part of him came out, in that looking for opportunities, what we did well, which a lot of it was agricultural lending, residential lending, and how to expand that. And when I left after working with him for 21 years, he was responsible for many things at the bank, including the lending function. And when I left, we were doing business in over 30 counties in Indiana and Ohio. He's got relationships all over the place, and he stays true to them. He's loyal to them, and small bank doesn't go out and just put out marketing campaigns. What it has to do to grow is to get to know the customer and build relationships and be personal. That's George to a T. If you know George, he's as outgoing and friendly, and can build those relationships. And he taught the loan department to do the same thing.
During his career at Bath State Bank, he met his wife, Tina. They married on September 20th, 2004, and blended their families. They have 4 children, Jennifer, George Jr., Renee, and Drew, and 6 grandchildren, Logan, Bryce, Caleb, Gavin, Adrian, and Corbin. Their children and grandchildren are their lives. They live each day for them and try to plan their schedules around them. They attend as many of their grandsons' athletic events as possible. Since retirement, George has enjoyed having the time to see family more often and be able to help support his dad. He is most proud of watching all 4 of his children grow up and have successful careers. George continues his community involvement and enjoys the board and committee positions he holds. Volunteerism has been part of his working career for many years. It is something he believes in, and he never limited the employees of Bath on the amount of time that they could spend on outside involvement. He believes that volunteerism makes our community strong, so he has never said no to a staff member that needed to be gone for a longer period of time.
His volunteerism, I mean, it's unmatched, really, as far as how involved he's been in different organizations. Junior Achievement, he has a long time connection with them, and promoting that within the bank, getting people involved and engaged in raising money and for different causes. He's just always promoted that. Actually, you look at the number of hours he gave to Junior Achievement or he gave to other organizations, that's got to come out of your time somewhere. And that means he's given up his personal time for the benefit of others. And that's just part of his makeup.
George's involvement with the youth in the community currently include Junior Achievement, Redmen of Richmond and Brookville, and the Reed Foundation Board, Stewardship and Governance Committees. His past involvement includes Franklin County Community Foundation Scholarship Committee, Indiana Bankers Association Board of Directors for 6 years, Indiana Bankers Association Audit Committee for 3 years, Dr. Seuss Read Across America, and serving on the Indiana Council for Economic Education. His involvement with Junior Achievement is extensive. He has served on the Board of Directors and the Executive Committee, as well as committees for golf and 5K fundraisers and the JA Scholarship. He has consulted in over 45 classes as a JA mentor. He has been the JA Volunteer of the Year, JA Board Member of the Year, and last year received an award for 35 years of service to JA.
And we were asked to do a class, and it was a senior economics class where we would go in and they formed a company, and we were the consultants for that company. And that's, I think it's 1987 that we started. We took a couple classes, we didn't just do one, and we did it kind of like a dog and pony show a little bit. And if you know George, he can live up to that with his personality and the way he does things. But we really enjoyed it. It was one day a week that we would meet with one or two classes. There was one year I know that we took three classes and really took that program and tried to make it into something. Enjoyed working with the kids. At that point, we saw the benefit and having the connection with them, and did that for 6 or 7 years. And then I kind of backed away from it for some other projects while George just went head first into the JA program.
Other honors include being elected to state officer for the Improved Order of the Red Men, a featured story in the Indiana Bankers Association Hoosier Bankers magazine, and receiving the Citizenship Award at Bath State Bank for community involvement. In business, his most vivid memory is working through the recessionary years at the bank with a dedicated staff while providing everything to their customers and community. He said this was the most challenging time in business. His happiest memory was being able to serve the public for over 40 years and helping families get the things in life that they need and want. He is most proud of the staff at Bath State Bank and to be part of the Bath family.
Yeah, one side of him that people might not see is the guy's compassionate. And in 2000, my son was a school teacher and a coach, and on his way back to a sectional volleyball game on a Saturday, he was in an accident and he lost his life. And so it was such a traumatic experience to go through. And Monday morning, George came and he showed up at my door with Brandon Logue, the individual that's taken his place as president. And along with his condolences and his sympathy, you know, they said, we got this. Don't worry about the bank. And, you know, that my sanity was dependent on that, because I just was in no shape to go back to the bank and take that on with everything else that was going on in my life. You know, I was out for a while. He said, come back whenever you're ready. If it's a year, come back. And boy, that it made a difference for me, made a difference for my family. And in that time period, I had a lot of irons in the fire, a lot of balls in the air, and I never told him about one of them, and never got a call. They did it, and that's just typical of his life. And you know, there's a lot of stories out there about him doing that. You see the humor, you see, you know, how he is and everything, but you don't necessarily know that, the compassion he has for people and their well-being.
George is a member of Holy Family Catholic Church. His hobbies include working out in his home gym and playing guitar. When asked what he hopes people will remember about him, George said, I always helped people, whether it was during normal work hours, through the week, or on weekends. No matter what time, I always try to be there for them.
I would like to say a hearty congratulations to a man that is well deserved of this honor and of any honor that he gets, just because of everything he gives back to everyone that knows him, to every organization he's been involved with. Congratulations, George. God bless you, and well deserved.
Junior Achievement is proud to honor one of this year's laureates for their 2022 Business Hall of Fame, Mr. George Farrell.
Congratulations, sir.
Thank you very much. I have a few people to thank this evening. I'd like to say a few words about junior achievement and then share a junior achievement experience with you. First of all, I have a lot of family here, and I'm not going to go through a lot of introductions, but there's one person that's always been there for me, always backed me up, always support me, and she's always been my number one fan. So I want to say a special thank you to my wife, Tina, who's sitting right there. To our children, their spouses, our grandchildren, the rest of my family, my close friends that are here, I want to thank you for being here tonight, and I want all of you to know that I'm very blessed to have each of you in my life. I'd like to thank Dennis Brock and Steve Moore for the video that they made this evening. I've known those two for a long time, and trust me, they could have said a lot more. That was probably the most nervous part of the evening for me. I want to thank my Bass State Bank family that's here, the employees and directors. And I want to thank the employees there that have taught junior achievement classes, that have participated in our fundraisers. And I want to thank Brandon Logue, the president, for any contributions that he's approved for junior achievement. Thank you, Brandon. I'd like to thank the selection committee for this evening, and to the other two inductees, Mike and Sue, I'd like to say congratulations. Junior achievement, during the time I've been in junior achievement, I've worked under many excellent executive directors and board presidents, but I especially want to recognize Melissa Davis and Craig Towns and the rest of our board members. And I want you to know we have an excellent group of people in charge of junior achievement. They're great community leaders, and it's been a wonderful opportunity for me to work with them. So a special thank you to our JA board. Junior achievement became a passion of mine many years ago. And with everything that's going on in this world, I just felt the education is very important. And if you look at the students that we teach, kindergarten through 12th grade, they're students today, but they'll be our citizens of tomorrow. Someday, some of them will be sitting out there in your chairs, making decisions for major corporations, making decisions to hire employees for their companies, not just to support their companies, but to support families, to support the economy. They're the ones that's going to be doing this. But we can't achieve this or reach any of our goals without you. So on behalf of the Board of Directors of Junior Achievement of Eastern Indiana, I want to say thank you to all of you for your financial contributions and to all of you that volunteered in the classroom. Now I'd like to share a junior achievement experience with you. And this is not my favorite experience or the one that's the best, but it's always the one that stands out in my mind over all the years, and you'll understand why when I tell you about it. Those of you that have consulted in the classroom, you know you prepare each time you go. My mother always taught me that proper preparation prevents poor performance, so I always made sure I was prepared before I went to the classroom. And you hope that these students learn from you, and sometimes you even bond with them. Well, it was many years ago, I was teaching an eighth grade class at Union County Middle School and had this real little boy in the class. His name was Pete. Everybody called him Petey. And he was always the first one to greet me when I went to the classroom. He was the first one to raise his hand when I asked a question. He was the first one to raise his hand if I needed a volunteer. And I thought, I have this great bond with this boy. He's really learning from me and he really likes me. Well, one day I went to class and he comes running up to me and he says, Mr. Farrell, I'm so excited. And I said, what's up, Petey? He said, a group of us from your class got invited to be greeters at the Junior Achievement Business Hall of Fame dinner at Forest Hills Country Club. And I'm so excited. I've never been to Forest Hills and I've never ate there, and I'm so excited to go. And I said, that's wonderful. I usually sign up to be a greeter at those dinners and we'll do it together. So we got there that evening. It was a warm evening. We were outside. And I was telling Petey how to shake hands with somebody, greet them, tell them where they need to go. So the first gentleman walks up to Petey. He puts out his hand to shake hands. He looks at him right in the eyes and says, good evening. And welcome to the Junior Achievement Business Hall of Fame. If you step inside, you can get your name tag. If you go across the hallway, you can get a drink and have a wonderful evening. And I thought, wow, this little eighth grade boy, that was perfect. And he said those exact words to everyone he greeted that night, not one word more, not one word less. So the evening went on. Pretty soon the executive director came out, said it's time to go, come in, get the program started. And I looked out in the parking lot, and there was one more gentleman coming. And I thought, how perfect. I have the executive director, myself, and Petey. She knows he's my student, and this is going to be so impressive. I leaned over to her, and I said, just listen to this. And gosh, I didn't know what was coming. So a gentleman walks up. Petey puts out his hand to shake hands. He looks at him right in the eye, and he says, good evening, and welcome to the Junior Achievement Business Hall of Fame. If you step inside, you can get your name tag. If you go across the hallway, you can get a drink, and have a wonderful evening. And though this is Mr. Farrell, he's my Junior Achievement teacher, and he can be boring. That really happened right outside these doors. Lastly, I'd just like to say that this has been one of the greatest honors in my life, and I'd like to thank everyone for sharing this evening with me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, George Farrell. Well, our final laureate this evening is known as a true leader in all aspects of life, Sue Miller.
Suzanne Keough Miller was born October 27, 1952 in Portsmouth, Ohio to parents James and Germaine Keough. She was raised in Anderson, Indiana, along with her five siblings, Jim, Mike, Deb, Chris, and Jean. Growing up, she remembers roaming the neighborhood every day with her siblings and the neighbor kids. They were seldom bored and only came in to eat. Sue's mom was a great cook and shared her love of cooking with all her children. To this day, the family continues the tradition of enjoying cooking and good food together, especially during the holidays. Sue attended Anderson High School and graduated in 1970. She then attended Purdue University and graduated with distinction in 1974 with a degree in agriculture, majoring in environmental science. While at Purdue in the spring of 1972, she met her husband, Mark. She had set up a recycling program for her dormitory, and he reached out for help in starting one for his residence hall. After several phone conversations, they found out they were in class together and met in person shortly after. They married on December 21st, 1974. From 1974 to 1977, Sue worked in Indianapolis for the State Planning Services Agency, a division under the Lieutenant Governor's Office. During this time, she drafted the application and administered Indiana's federal grant for coastal zone management funds for the Lake Michigan shoreline. While working in Indianapolis, she took several classes through the IUPUI School of Public and Environmental Affairs. In 1977, Mark graduated from the Indiana University School of Dentistry under the Armed Forces Health Profession Scholarship Program. This requires 4 years of service in the Army. They were stationed in Korea for 1 year and Madigan Army Medical Center in Tacoma, Washington for 3 years. After returning to the States and buying a home, Sue saw a sign at H&R Block offering classes on learning to prepare taxes. At the time, she was just hoping to learn to prepare her own tax return. This led to 3 years of seasonal tax preparation work and laid the foundation for a new career goal. Sue and Mark moved to Richmond in 1981 with their one-year-old daughter, Megan. Sue began taking classes at Indiana University East with the goal of completing the 40 credit hours in business and accounting required to sit for the CPA exam and become a CPA. In 1982, their son Mark was born. Sue continued taking one or two classes per semester and was named a distinguished student in accounting at IU East. In May 1985, she sat for the CPA exam and received the high grade award in the state of Indiana, as well as the Elijah Watt Sales Award, which recognizes outstanding performance on the CPA exam. In January 1986, she approached Brady Ware with a unique proposal, asking if they would hire her as a permanent flex-time employee. And her wish was granted. She began employment with Brady Ware and worked there for the next 33 years.
So Sue was a leader from the very first day at Brady Ware as by becoming our first flex time and seasonal person. Now this is back in the early to mid 80s when CPA firms traditionally hired degreed accountants or CPAs. So this was a very new concept of hiring a seasonal only or a flex time person. But Sue was really bright, so Brady Ware hired her.
Sue's list of accomplishments during her years at Brady Ware is long. During her third year, she was placed in charge of reviewing, selecting, and implementing in-house tax software. Prior to this, the process of completing tax returns took several days, sending worksheets back and forth to Texas. Sue received the floppy disk of the selected software, installed it, keyed in one of Brady Ware's largest returns, and had a completed return in less than an afternoon. Eureka! In 2001, she and two others were assigned to lead the conversion of Brady Ware to paperless.
Sue led Brady Ware in its effort to go paperless. And that was back in the early 2000s. We were one of the very first firms in the country to go paperless. She studied the requirements, developed the procedures. What would it take to convert all these file cabinets full of records and all the paper that's stacked up on everybody's desk and routed folder to folder, from office to office? How do we get to do that paperless by electronic record? After a year or so, after Sue had developed these procedures, she was asked to present on this topic to the Leading Edge Alliance, which is our firm association. It's one of the largest firm associations in the country. And typically, the firms in that association are much larger regional CPA firms. Here was Sue presenting on how do you go paperless to these much larger firms, and doing it after we'd already been paperless for a couple of years, thanks to her efforts.
Her most vivid memory includes Luke Ware, a 65-year-old curmudgeon. During her interview, he handed her a piece of paper and asked her to write something, a test of legible handwriting. Well, this wasn't a good start for Sue, because she consistently expected C's in penmanship during school. But after two tax seasons, Mr. Ware called her into his office and said that hiring her was the best thing they had ever done. Sue cherishes that memory. As a CPA, she always looked at accounting as a means to serve others. Her goal with clients, both business and individual, was to help them manage their finances and understand and apply the tax laws to their benefit. She is especially proud of the work she has done helping organizations obtain and maintain their tax-exempt status.
When she joined the firm, we had 20 people in a single office. Her responsibility was to develop procedures that would allow us to grow. When she left, we had 4 offices in 3 states with well over 100 people, all using the procedures and policies that Sue helped to develop and to lead.
Sue has served the community over the years on many boards, including Richmond Municipal Airport, Cope Environmental Center, Psi Lota Xi, Birth to Five, Communities and Schools, AAUW Nursery School, and Wayne County Area Chamber of Commerce. She received the Outstanding Committee Member Award from the Chamber for Agribusiness Committee in 2016 and Agribusiness Volunteer in 2017.
I met Sue for the first time, at least in a way that we really got to know each other, when I came to work at the Chamber of Commerce and she was chairing the Agribusiness Committee at that time. And so she and I worked together a lot through that relationship, pulling off farm tours annually for 6 years in a row, something like that. And she was just always this smile when she came into the room. She just was so peaceful, but also very focused. And so I just fully enjoyed working with her in that way.
She has also served on the Richmond Sanitary Board for close to 15 years. She was formerly on the Finance Committee at Central Methodist Church, involved with Charles PTO and youth soccer programs, and taught JA in the classroom.
I think Sue is one of those people that when she sees a need that she can do anything about, she steps up and volunteers and she gives back. She wants to donate her talents to better the community for the next generation. An example of that would be the pickleball courts over in Clear Creek Park. She and a group, small group of others really wanted to add that as a quality of life piece in our community and started talking to people about it. And within a short amount of time, she had garnered enough support and came to us and wanted to work through the Chamber Center for Excellence to raise money and be able to pull that off. And she and a few others led that charge, but that's that entrepreneurial mindset that we want people to have. That's what's gonna grow our community, that's what's gonna grow our businesses, and Sue demonstrates that so well.
Sue is most proud of her children and grandchildren, daughters Megan and Claire, son Marcus, and eight grandkids, Reed, Owen, Elizabeth, Margot, Holden, Bennett, Theo, and May. The kids and spouses are bright, funny, caring, and exhibit strong work ethics. The whole family shares a joy of outdoors. Some very special memories include family vacations at the beach, in the mountains, at state and national parks. Sue's hobby of walking, hiking, camping, and gardening allow her to get out in nature and enjoy its restorative powers. Other hobbies include cross-stitch, knitting, crocheting, reading, and playing pickleball. So many people have been important to Sue in her personal and work life, but family is key. They are not only family, but best friends. She is thankful for experiencing life with her husband, Mark, and their shared beliefs that are still present after 47 years. She has been surrounded by impressive women, mother, aunt, sisters, sisters-in-law, and daughters, who at one time or another, Sue has looked to for their wise counsel. She hopes that those who have surrounded her know that this is in large part their lifting her up that has allowed her to achieve what she has. She is better for their efforts.
When Sue is a part of an organization, you feel the impact. And when Sue's term is up and it's time for her to move on, you feel the impact. And I think that that is what makes her the perfect recipient for this honor. I would just say to Sue, congratulations from the bottom of my heart. You are so deserving, and I just cannot think of a more suitable recipient for this year's recognition.
Junior Achievement is proud to honor one of this year's laureates for their 2022 Business Hall of Fame, Mrs. Sue Miller.
My weaknesses is public speaking. I just want to thank JA for giving me this award. I want to, when I stood behind the curtain and I saw those people who have preceded me and I see their names, then I'm humbled by the group that I am amongst. I thank all the work that JA has put into this, the board members, and the continuation of recognition of members of our community. I first want to certainly give recognition to Brady Ware. They took a flyer on me when I was 33 years old and out of the workforce and raising a family and taking a few classes here and there. But I'm also especially thrilled by the fact that while their dream was to become a premier regional accounting firm, they never overlooked the return to the community, to giving back to the community, to encourage all of us to participate in the community. They could see that their growth and the growth of the community was going to go hand in hand. And as mentioned in the piece, the people that I've worked with for so many years there did lift me up, and we lifted each other up, and we were all able to accomplish what we did. I also want to thank, again, as noted in the piece, all of the many organizations that have allowed me to share in their mission for the betterment of Richmond. And that's the Wayne County Chamber, Communities and Schools, the Cope Environmental Center, the city through the Sanitary Board and the parks, so many different organizations that I've enjoyed sharing their mission. And then I also have to give recognition to my parents, the parents who said, anything that you want to accomplish, you can, just work hard and you can accomplish it. And I see that in my children and I see it in my grandchildren. They work hard to achieve what they want to achieve. So set your goals high and you can achieve them. Lastly, I have to give thanks to my husband, friend, partner for so many years, who has shared so many different things that we never knew we were going to, the road we were going to path, the path we were going to go down when we started all of this out so many years ago. And then many thanks to my children, my grandchildren, my siblings who are here with me this evening. All of you are the loves of my life and keep me going. And that's why we need to make the world a better place for the future. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sue Miller. Well, congratulations to all of tonight's honorees. Junior Achievement is proud to honor these three laureates tonight, and they've helped make Eastern Indiana a great community in which to live and work. Ladies and gentlemen, this does conclude our event for this evening. Again, thank you so much for being here. Have a good night and a safe trip.